Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to be showing you how to solve for the stoichiometric fuel-to-air ratio. This is an important topic for jet engine analysis or internal combustion analysis, among other things. I'm going to start with a general case and then I'll go through an example for you with real numbers. And so we're going to start with that general hydrocarbon that's reacting with air. So the hydrocarbon here is CmHn, where m and n can be any numbers, and it's reacting with air here, which I'll talk about in a second. And it's reacting to form water, CO2, and N2. And this is a stoichiometric reaction, which means that there's no excess fuel or oxidizer on the right-hand side. Note that this is a global reaction mechanism, so it's a one-step process here. In reality, when you have a fuel reacting with an oxidizer, you can have hundreds of steps of this reaction, but in this case, we're looking at a global reaction to simplify things down. Now, the first thing that gets glossed over by a lot of people doing explanations on this is the standard air assumption here. So why is it 1O2 plus 3.76N2? Well, we're making the assumption that our air is composed of 21% O2 by volume and 79% N2 by volume, and we're ignoring all the other trace species that are in the actual air. And so when it says by volume, it means you can also express it as a mole fraction. So the mole fraction of O2 in the air is 0.21, and the mole fraction of the N2 in air is 0.79, and these two add up to 1 because the sum of the mole fractions of the air has to add up to be equal to 1. And so what we can do then is normalize by the mole fraction of O2. And so for each mole of O2, and the single mole comes from the fact that we're normalizing by O2, so 0.21 divided by 0.21 is 1. That means that we have 0.79, that's the mole fraction of N2 divided by 0.21, the mole fraction of O2, moles of N2. And if you do this division here, you end up getting 3.76. So that's why air is given as 1O2 plus 3.76N2. So here I've rewritten the global reaction with the unknowns in black. We don't know A, B, C, and D. That's what we're trying to solve for. We do know M and N because we'll know what fuel type we're using. So what we're trying to do is solve for A, B, C, and D in terms of M and N. And since we have four unknowns, we're going to need four equations, and we'll use atom balances. So we'll start with the atom balance for carbon. So for carbon, see that we have M here, nothing else over here, and then we have C. So we have M on the left-hand side is equal to C on the right-hand side, so that's our first equation. Now we go to hydrogen. Here we have N, nothing else on this side, and we have 2 times B here. So N is equal to 2B. If we go to oxygen, here we have 2 times A on the left-hand side, and then we have 1 times B plus 2 times C. So we have our 2A is equal to B plus 2C. And finally, for nitrogen, we have 2 times 3.76 times A. That's this on the left-hand side. And then over here, just 2 times D is equal to 2 times D. And now we can simplify these down. We can see that this one, if we just flip it around, we have C is equal to M. So that one's all ready to go. And this one, we just divide both sides by 2, and we get B is equal to N over 2. This one here, we're trying to solve for A because we already know C and B. So we're trying to solve for A, and so we divide both sides by 2, so we get B plus 2C over 2, and we know values of B and C already, so we plug these in for B and C here. We get this expression here, and I'm just going to flip the terms around. So we have 2M over 2 is equal to M, and N over 2 divided by 2 is N over 4, so A is equal to M plus N over 4. And finally, we can solve for D because we now know A, and so the 2's cancel out here, so we just have 3.76A is equal to D, and that's what this is saying. And we just plug this value in for A here, and we get our final expression for D down here. So now for this global reaction here, we know everything A, B, C, and D in terms of the values of M and N that define our fuel. So now to continue, let's use some real numbers. We're going to be going through the example with C10H22, which is also called n-decane, and this is just typical of an aviation fuel. And so M is equal to 10, N is equal to 22, and now we need to solve for A, B, C, and D, where the equations are rewritten here again. So let's solve for A first. We have M plus N divided by 4, so A is 15.5. For B, we have N divided by 2, so B is 11. For C, we just have C is equal to M, so C is equal to 10. And then for D, we just multiply A times 3.76, and we get D is equal to 58.28. And if we plug all these values back up into our global reaction, we get C10H22 plus 15.5 times the standard air. It gives us 11H2O plus 10CO2 plus 58.28N2, and that's our balanced stoichiometric reaction. So now that we have the balanced global reaction, we can go on to solve what this video is actually about, the fuel-to-air ratio. So I've rewritten the balanced equation up here, and we're going to solve for the fuel-to-air ratio, which is defined as with the letter F, lowercase f, and is the fuel over air, so you might also see it as F over A. And so there's two ways that you can define the fuel-to-air ratio. The first is on a molar basis, and the second is on a mass basis. And so if we just do the molar basis first, F is equal to the moles of the fuel over the moles of the air. So the moles of the fuel, there's only one C10H22, so that's 1. And for the air, we have 15.5 moles of O2 and 15.5 times 3.76 moles of N2, so that's why we have that written in the denominator here, and that means that on a molar basis, our fuel-to-air ratio is 0.0136. However, for jet engine analysis and other types of analyses, depending on the problem, the mass basis is used, so if you use the molar basis fuel-to-air ratio, you'll get the wrong answer. So the mass basis fuel-to-air ratio is defined as F is equal to the mass of the fuel over the mass of the air, and to get the mass of the fuel in the air, we need to weight the number of moles in our equation here using the molecular weight. So we can say that the moles, that's what we have up here, times grams per mole, you can see that the moles cancel when you get it in terms of grams, will give us this mass basis, and you can see that this here, this term is the molecular weight. So in order to weight these moles up here, we need to find the molecular weights, and so the first one is the molecular weight of the fuel, C10H22, it's 10 times the molecular weight of carbon plus 22 times the molecular weight of hydrogen is equal to 10 times 12 grams per mole plus 22 times 1 gram per mole gives us the molecular weight of the fuel as 142 grams per mole. For the O2, we just have 2 times the molecular weight of oxygen, which is 2 times 16, is equal to 32 grams per mole. And then same for N2, gives us 28 grams per mole. And now finally, all we need to do is solve for the fuel-to-air ratio by finding the mass of the fuel and the mass of the air using these molecular weights that we solved for on the previous whiteboard. So the mass of the fuel is 1 mole times 142 grams per mole. And you can see that the moles cancel and we get grams on the top, so we get 142 grams in the numerator. For the air, we have 15.5 moles of O2, so 15.5 moles times the molecular weight of O2 is here, and then for the N2, we have 15.5 times 3.76 moles times the molecular weight of nitrogen, which is 28, and that gives us 2127.8 grams for the mass of the air, and if we divide those two numbers, we get the fuel-to-air stoichiometric, which you'll see written as F subscript ST is equal to, or F over A stoichiometric, and that's going to be equal to 0.067. So thanks for watching.